I'm Colleen Terry, co-curator of the Summer of Love Experience, Art, Fashion, and Rock and Roll, on view in the De Young's Herbst Exhibition Galleries through August 20th. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the first in a three-part series of Friday night conversations with artists that we featured in the exhibition. I hope you've had a chance to see the exhibition already, and if you haven't, that tonight's event will entice you into the galleries at some point in the exhibition's concluding weeks. Before I introduce tonight's speakers, I'd like to alert you to next week's conversation. On August 11th, legendary Liquid Light show artist Bill Ham will discuss his creative process and motivation with Fine Arts Museum's chief curator and founding curator of photography, Julian Cox, in this auditorium at 7 p.m. Then, on August 18th, Julian will be speaking with Ben Van Meter, the experimental filmmaker and light show artist, who will share five films that he made in the years leading up to the Summer of Love. I hope you will be able to join us for these exciting programs as well. Tonight, we will hear from Stanley Mouse, who, along with his creative partner, Alton Kelly, was one of the leading creators of posters advertising San Francisco's dance concerts in the years surrounding the Summer of Love. Stanley also designed numerous album covers for the Grateful Dead and other of San Francisco's legendary musical groups. I won't say too much about Stanley, since I know we'll hear all about him over the course of this evening. But I do want to point out that not only will you find his posters throughout our special exhibition galleries, but he also designed the exhibition's commemorative poster, which is currently available in our shop. Stanley is joined in conversation by my friend and colleague, Victoria Binder, who is the Associate Paper Conservator here at the Fine Arts Museums of San Francisco. Victoria received her BA in Art History from New York University and her MA and CAS in Art Conservation from the State University of Buffalo. Prior to joining the Fine Arts Museums in 2009, she was a fellow at the Museums of Fine Arts Boston, where she first began her research into the art of the Roth poster. Since then, Victoria has pursued this topic with enthusiasm, publishing in 2010 an article titled "The San Francisco Roth Poster and the Art of Photo Offset Lithography" in the American Institute for Conservation's Book and Paper Group Annual. I've heard this article described by many poster specialists as an instant classic, and it remains the definitive source on how the posters of the era were made. We were fortunate to include an expanded version of this article in our own exhibition catalog, and in the exhibition itself, Victoria has developed a gallery display that I'm sure you will agree brilliantly synthesizes a very complicated process. Early in her research, Victoria made contact with many of the poster artists and printers, and over the last 10 years, some, including Stanley, have become very good friends. I know we are in for a treat tonight as we hear the two friends in conversation. Please join me in welcoming Stanley and Victoria.
Trying to get to the root of that question, and why did I take acid at that time? And the closest I can figure out is that, in the, I think Timothy Leary and Alpert was meddling with acid in Harvard, and I think it got spread around to the universities. I was going to art school in Detroit, which was connected to the university, Wayne State. And people were experimenting with LSD, which is, it was perfectly okay because it was legal. And my first trip was pharmaceutical. It was Sandoz.
Like, who got them, and remember what it was like?
I don't remember where it came from, but I remember it was really good acid. I could see people's veins in their bodies. And everything was like liquid. And molecules and rocks were moving, and trees were alive and talking to me.
You once said to me that LSD brought us out of the dark ages and cured the 1950s.
Well, the 50s were like two-dimensional. There were good things in the 50s, like there was some great black music, and there was good car design.
Because you grew up in Detroit,
I grew up in
right?
Detroit.
Yeah.
I was born in California, but because of the war, my parents moved back to Detroit, and so I grew up in Detroit. And I experienced like the birth of rock and roll through in the 50s, and it was very two-dimensional, and I think the 60s brought in like a three-dimensional world, maybe four, five, or six, or seven.
And can you tell me what it was like being in Detroit at that time with the music?
Well, the only place you could listen to black music was on jukeboxes. They put black music on jukeboxes, but they wouldn't play it on radios. It was taboo. And they would whitewash it and have like Pat Boone do Tutti Frutti, you know, Little Richard's Tutti Frutti. Really bad dancers. But the real thing was like, they could hear on the jukeboxes, like at my high school hangout, it was like Little Richard doing the real thing. But the whitewash didn't last long. Finally, black music became mainstream. And that, to me, that was like the birth of rock and roll. And at the time, can you go to the slide?
Yeah, definitely.
I was painting hot rod monster.
So
you're
18
teachers.
Years old in this picture here, so 18 and already famous.
Actually, I was famous in the seventh grade. Soon as I
got that wrong.
Soon as I was signed everything mouse in the seventh grade.
But you're painting these hot rod monsters, yeah. And airbrushing them, yeah, on t-shirts. You're nationally known, right?
I went to a lot of hot rod shows all over the country and painted. And I must have painted like 10,000 of those things.
So that's really, really developed.
So my hand was like an Olympic athlete.
Yeah, that's one of your most famous guys, isn't it? It's a Fred.
My character, Fred Fleibauger. Yeah. And then when I was doing that, I actually had a booth at the State Fair in Michigan, and behind me was the Motown band shell, and there was all the Motown acts in their heyday playing behind me while I was airbrushing in fluorescent colors and smoking a little pot. And I said to myself, this is like You can't get much better than this. And it was really a great experience.
And so you really had a good thing going on in Detroit, right?
So to get back to Wayne State University and the LSD, we experimented more and more with LSD and peyote and psychedelics. And then there was a calling from, it seemed, from San Francisco. And I knew a few people like Jim Gurley from the Big Brother and Holy Company. He was from Detroit, and I heard he was in a rock band in San Francisco. And then there was this kind of music that I heard. It was like a siren calling.
And what made you go to San Francisco? I remember you went, the first time you moved to the Bay Area was to like Oakland, Berkeley area. Did you go by yourself or did you go with friends? What was that kind of siren call that brought you there?
I think
it was the summer of 1965, right?
Yeah, I think there was some music for this.
Oh.
Music. There was this great song coming from the West Coast.
What brought you to San Francisco this first time, and tell us about this first
move. So a bunch of us got in a caravan and drove to San Francisco. Coming across Golden Gate Bridge, somebody said in the car, they said, "How long are you going to stay here?" And I looked at the city and I said, "Forever."
Yeah. And
I ended up in this little place in Berkeley.
Do you recognize that?
It's still there.
This is like a Telegraph Avenue, right? Where Berkeley,
Telegraph Avenue, like 55th Street.
Right.
This is how it looks today, I think. But then it had an awning in it. And,
and you moved in with your girlfriend and your dog, I think.
Yeah.
Right? So how did two people fit into there?
It was like camping out. But it was summertime. It was beautiful.
Yeah.
And I kind of wanted to be like in the peace movement in Berkeley, but I found out really quick that they were having way more fun in San Francisco. And I would go over to San Francisco and I met Kelly there.
And Kelly, your creative partner, for 50 years, and one of the founders of Family Dog.
And I met a bunch of people that they lived on Pine Street, and they were the Family Dog group. And
I have a picture, actually, of Alton Kelly right here. Can you tell me, as I was saying, he is your creative partner. He is one of the founding members of the Family Dog and all the dance companies at Avalon Ballroom. Can you tell me about how you first met him?
Yeah, I met him that year in 65, but then I got drafted and went back to Detroit and took a lot of acid and went to my induction day and they kicked me out. I had my girlfriend point me at the door.
I have heard that you said you overwhelmed them with a vision of peace and love.
actually, I wanted to be crazy, so they kicked me out. But I looked at everybody else was trying to be crazy, and I was the only sane person. Maybe sane to them was crazy.
So you left in September 1965. To go back to Detroit, and then...
So you can, in Detroit, you can get cars, because they built cars there, and then you can get driveaways, and you can drive a car to L.A. or to wherever you want to get a car to. And so I called, and they said, "Sorry, all we have is a hearse." I said, "Oh, perfect." So I put a Make Love Not War sticker on the back of the hearse. And loaded up the dog and the girlfriend and all my stuff, and we drove to San Francisco and got there the night of the acid
Trans Festival.
festival.
Yeah, January 1965.
But we were way too tired to go in. We just flipped in the car.
Right, but by then things have really taken off, right? By then, yeah.
Again, things were going on. Yeah. They had, I guess, in '65 they were having parties, and go figure. I always had a great party, and then they always the parties got bigger and bigger and bigger until they had to rent halls.
I remember you mentioning going to Bill Ham's Victorian.
Oh, right, yeah. One time Bill Ham had, he would do this weekly where James Gurley would come in and play guitar, and Bill Ham would show his liquid lights in his studio, and everybody would sit around and get high and watch it. It was great. Very great. Very
and,
good.
And then Alton Kelly, I remember you told me about the first time you met him. What was your first impression?
Oh, right. Kelly, it was in '65, and he was sitting in I walked into his house, and he was sitting in the corner on a pile of debris, and there was a bunch of people around him, and he was like a guru talking to his people. And he was just talking, it was very interesting. And I sat there and listened to him. There was an AM radio, they only had AM at the time, it was screeching in the corner. And, that made an impression on me. I said, who is this guy? And so when I came back to San Francisco after the draft, I had a Porsche. I came out to California in a new Porsche. Because I was making a lot of money paying hot rod t-shirts.
Yeah.
And it had a broken axle. And so I heard Kelly was a motorcycle mechanic, and I asked him if he'd try to fix my car. He didn't fix it, but we got to be really good friends. And
so is it through him that you first started making rock posters for the venues like the Fillmore and the Avalon?
He was the art director for the Avalon Ballroom. He was actually, him and some people started the Family Dog dances. And I think they had a few dances, and it was successful, and they made some money, so they all went to Mexico to score some weed. Sounds stupid now, doesn't it? And when they left, Chet Helms took over the Family Dog because it was just floundering, I guess. And so when Kelly got back, he became the art director. And so Kelly brought over Chet Helms to my studio, and he said, "We don't want no cartoons." He stuck with me. That stuck with me all my life, I think. So I did a poster, and it was the first poster, Captain Beefheart poster.
Have it right here. It
was okay. It wasn't great. It was okay.
I love the tongue and the buck teeth, though. It's pretty awesome visual play. It's pretty cool. I do have here, though, the first poster that
did. But then Kelly and I got together.
Yeah.
I said, let's get together and do some posters, because he had a great conceptual mind, and I had the great hand. And so we did, and we did this one. It kind of started. I rented a firehouse on Henry Street in San Francisco, an old firehouse. And we're standing in front of it, and this guy was walking down the street, and he looks like the Zigzag Man, and he's got a Zigzag Man t-shirt on.
Zigzag rolling papers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we said, "Hey, you, come over here." And so he came over, and it was Gut.
The artist. Yeah, cool.
And we talked, and then we had this idea of, why not do it as a poster?
Risk, though, were you
well, it was scary, because either Zigzag was going to come out after us for copyright, or the police were going to come and bust us. And so we cleaned the studio really good, and nothing happened. Matter of fact, Zigzag shut their mouths and got $1 million advertising campaign, because they couldn't advertise to potheads, because it would... They couldn't do it. They weren't allowed to do something like that.
Stanley,
somebody wrote a whole article about that.
They did. There's a quote at the bottom. It says, you don't know about copying and duplicating won't hurt you.
I think that was Chet Helms.
That was Chet Helms. Chet Helms kind of started that format of, you know, using an image or a theme for the Avalon, and then you guys kind of went with that. But art has always copied and duplicated and replicated. But I think it seems that kind of appropriating an image and reshuffling it the way you guys did was part of the zeitgeist at the time, right? Like the clothing, you could see how they, you know, use, like you mentioned wearing Victorian clothing and Western and the music they were sampling as well, and even the name Big Brother and the Holding Company, right? Isn't that appropriated in some ways?
I'm not sure.
You're telling me like how Big Brother,
yeah,
like,
I don't know
before,
that Chet Helms came up with it and he thought it was cool.
And the Holding Company though, where does that?
Well, there was, back when pot was illegal and there were code words for it. Actually, that's when pot was fun to smoke. It was like romantic, you know. The romance of marijuana, it was beautiful. But there was code words, and one of them was, are you holding? It means, do you have any weed on you?
So that's where Big Brother and the Holding Company.
And I don't know why Big Brother, but I don't know how they came up.
Someone told me Chet Helms was Big Brother, right? Because he managed them.
Yeah. I don't know.
Okay, here we have a handful of posters that you and Alton Kelly did together with their original sources. And just to point out a few quickly, like in the top left, we have Von Strucksen Lady. In the middle, we Steichen with the Gloria Swanson. And we have Winnie the Pooh at the bottom, the Piglet, and looks like Piglet smoking a spliff. And I wanted to know, when you guys were creating these posters, what made you pick out images for particular bands or venues?
Like, I think this is where Kelly's genius came in. He kind of knew great images like that. Like he found it from the Life magazine. That's how they fitted space astronauts with their helmets, with those light beams.
Right. And where would you find those images?
It was on the cover of Life magazine.
There
was a shop in San Francisco that was all old magazines, tons of old magazines. That was a great source.
Yeah, I mean, all these images have such an immediacy to them.
The Sin Dance lady,
the
Franz Stuck lady, she was used by Wes Wilson for a poster, and it didn't happen. Something happened. It was called Sin Dance. And so I always liked that image, so I tried using it, and it came out. Actually, I used it on another one, and it didn't come out.
I know,
and this
one
is the third try.
Yeah. And you can see so many influences in it. I know Art Nouveau was really important to you, and you can also just see the diversity of your style when you look at them, all the different borders, and also just so many different lettering. Like, how did you, you know, make up all these different letterings for that particular?
One thing that Kelly and I did was go to the San Francisco main library, and in it they had what they called the stacks, and it was these books that they didn't loan out. You know, they had a great collection of old poster art, and so we would go in there and just look through all that stuff.
And did you find lettering books there, or how did
there was
you...
lettering books and everything, yeah.
Very cool.
And so we studied, like we, you know, from coming from Detroit to a year later, I was totally a different person.
And can you tell me, you were talking about your working relationship with Kelly. It just seems like it was destiny, the two of you, that you had this great partnership. And
yeah, there was, I think, totally there was destiny in it. And I was the hand, and he was like conceptual part.
I have a quote from you that I have to read that I like, where it says, "He was a lefty, and I was right-handed. We could sit at the drawing board and work on the same piece together like a four-handed monster."
Yeah, this is after we worked together for 15 years. He got really good with his hand, And we could sit at the painting, and we get some, like, a lot of really tremendous airbrush album covers that we did.
Right.
Like for Journey and
Steve Miller is amazing. let's see, forward. It's not clicking forward, Rich.
This is the end.
I know, we reached the end. We were afraid this would happen.
Now what do we do?
Game revival, like we always have.
Well.
I could read my note. The 60s was a portal to an interdimensional multi-universe. And possibly a door to parallel worlds.
Yeah.
We were explorers of inner space.
Well, thank you for ending up here, Nick.
Yeah.
That was a beautiful portal.
I think we're in a portal right now. Well, the next set of images, and I hope Rich can help me move these forward so everyone can see it, but luckily they're actually in the exhibition, and they're in the gallery on how the posters are made.
So the story about the Skull and Roses.
Oh, I don't know. Actually, let's talk about Skeleton and Roses. Well, you know what I was going to talk to you about, actually, Stanley, was, you know, the Howlin' Wolf, your original drawings? So there's a gallery, and you can see all of his original art that he used to make the Howlin' Wolf poster, which was September 1966, the really cool green wolf. And it was like three images, and they were all in black and white. One was an illustration board, and two were on acetate overlays. Can you tell me a little bit about actually making the posters, like why they were in black and white? And what you had to do to make them?
Well, the printer printed one color at a time. So he printed the black, which is pretty much the illustration. And then the color had to be done with acetate overlays. You put a clear plastic over it, and then you color, or you ink in where you want, like, the red. In that case, it was red and green.
Right, so each overlay was
in
the
so
black.
So one for red and one for green. And then when the printer prints all those together, they come out. And that's it on the right.
So, yay! So that must have been cool.
Oh, there they are, right there.
Yeah. So it must have been cool to see, you know, because you're working in just black and white, to actually see it, like, right, in color all over the street, right?
And you really don't know what it's going to come out like, because you're just kind of guessing at the colors. So you have a book of colors. You say, I want this color and this color. But you really don't know what it's going to look like, so it's kind of an experiment.
Right, because these were printed on giant offset litho machines about the size of a small car. And you actually lived around the corner from Bindweed Press, right?
I was lucky to live
right
around the corner from Bindweed Press.
Yeah, that's Frank Westlake. Can you tell me what it was like printing with him, actually printing the posters and seeing them in color for the first time?
I have a good story that... One night, I was tripping, and Frank was printing the girl with green hair. Do you have a picture of that?
The girl, that's later on. We can go forward to that.
It was a warm San Francisco night, which was rare. and it was, I think, October. And he collected pump organs. So along with his printing press, he had several pump organs. And I went in there, and this printing press was going ticka, 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 ticka. And I sat down at the pump organ and started playing to the rhythm of my poster being printed, and the colors coming off.
Yeah, so then you
know.
So you said you were tripping while you were doing that. Yeah. I want to ask you a question.
And then the next day, I saw them up all over town. They were posted in all the windows and all the poles. And it was a beautiful October day. And then the concert that weekend was as beautiful as the poster or vice versa.
Oh, cool. Did you do acid while you made the posters?
No. Like Victor Moscoso says, if he did any psychedelics while he was doing posters, his pencil would melt into the paper.
But he must have smoked weed and listened to music.
But the thing I would do is I would look at what I had done in a normal state when I was tripping, and I would say, how did I ever have all that together to do all that at once? Which proves that the normal state is the highest optimum working condition.
You know, did you and Kelly know that you were on to something good when you were making these posters? Was there like a moment where you're like, we're doing something awesome here?
Every day at the time it seemed like almost a year. And there's so much happened in one day. And there's so much happening all at once. And we were doing these posters that were sort of miraculous, even to ourselves. You know, we're going, wow, we're doing this. And my girlfriend said, let's quit this stuff and poster stuff and go to the country and have kids. And I went, and I'm going, no,
no.
She threw the ink bottle across the room and there was ink everywhere. But we knew we had the tiger by the tail at the time.
And what happened to the girlfriend?
She ran off with chicken belly.
Chicken belly.
Did you write about that?
What?
What was, did you art about that?
She's asking if you did art about her running off with chicken belly.
I don't think so.
Oh, okay. I have a picture of you and Alton and Kelly, and you guys are in Mouse Studios. And I knew Mouse Studios, a lot happened there. It's a cool place both inside and out. Can you tell us a little bit about what it was like on the outside and the inside going song?
It was an old horse-drawn firehouse, and it had troughs in it. And,
it's on Henry Street, right? By Noe, right?
Yeah.
No longer there.
Henry Noe, beautiful little neighborhood, really cute neighborhood.
Yeah.
And this was upstairs, and it had a balcony all around it, and this was upstairs. And Big Brother and Holy Company practiced downstairs. And Chet Helms brought over Janis Joplin, this is my famous story, and to audition for the band. And so she did. And they all came up after and said, what do you think about her? And I said, she's either really good or she's really bad. Actually, I still think that way too. Music.
Yeah, we need some Big Brother and the Holding Company.
Actually, Big Brother were a great band before Janis. This is the only song I could find that didn't have Janis in it.
Because you were friends with James Gurley and everyone from Detroit, right? You had your Detroit.
Yeah, I was friends with them. That night, Push showed up at my door, and they said, we have a report of a woman screaming. I explained to him that it was Janis auditioning for the band.
Well, Mouse Studios seem like an awesome place.
I became really good friends with Janis.
She wasn't so bad.
She was really cool. People asked me if I hung around with the Grateful Dead, and I said, no, I hung around with Janis.
That's not a bad alternative.
What was her best quality?
Her freedom.
Good question.
And her
laugh.
I didn't like Bobby McGee, though.
We've debated this one. Which was your favorite Big Brother song?
Well, Chris Christopherson wrote
that. That is a good one. Yeah. His version is good. Yes.
I don't remember, but I remember seeing Big Brother at the Matrix playing before Janis, and they were amazing, just totally amazing. They were the best band. Janis kind of turned them into the Janis Joplin show, and then eventually destroyed them, and spit them out.
What was it like going to the Avalon and the Fillmore?
The Avalon was really great. That's where the real scene was. Everybody danced like 3-4 nights a week with great bands, great drugs. It was unbelievable. And people came from all over the world to experience it. And the Fillmore was different. People didn't dance much at the Fillmore. They sat on the floor and watched. And it wasn't the local scene, it was more people from out of town and stuff.
Yeah.
But the real scene was at the Avalon, and then the media picked up on it and broadcasted it everywhere. The scene in San Francisco was so cool.
Would you hang out backstage at the Avalon?
Yeah, lucky. I was lucky to be able I had carte blanche on the back room. And so I got to hang out with all the musicians.
They must have been Big Brother and Holding Company were your good friends.
The funny thing is, I was backstage with Jefferson Airplane maybe 100 times and I never talked to any of them.
Huh.
It's so weird.
Yeah, it's totally weird. well, clearly, you were intricately part of the scene and making rock posters from within the scene. And we have here one of your most famous ones, of course, The Grateful Dead, Skeleton and Roses, I think September 1966. And we're really lucky that we have here in our exhibition not only the poster, but your original art, and Alton Kelly's, and the book page. And this one, I was wondering if you could tell us the story behind this iconic image.
Well, Kelly and I got a job from the Avalon to do Grateful Dead poster. Grateful Dead was just one of the bands that were playing. And they had a great name, we liked the name a lot. And actually, I liked the Grateful Dead in their early days with Big Pen. They were great. They were like a gritty blues band. But, so we went to the library to try to figure out some kind of source material to use for a Grateful Dead poster. And we're looking through books, and we came across the Rubaiyat of Omar Khayyam. And in it was all these great skeletons. And we found this one. And
this is an illustration by Edmund Solomon.
Yeah, said, that's got Grateful Dead all over it. So usually I tell people that we Xeroxed it and used it, but there wasn't Xerox machines back then. And I had a talk at the San Francisco Library last year, and I fessed up that Kelly actually cut it out of the book with his penknife. I figured they can't prosecute him now.
You have a big library fine.
And they didn't seem upset at all. They were entertained by it, I think. But we took that and had a photostat made of it, and taped it to a illustration board, and I did the lettering around it.
That's beautiful.
The rest was history.
Yeah. It's an iconic poster. There you go. Oh. Yes. And I just put these up here to show how the Skeleton and Roses has been such a theme throughout yours and Kelly's career. My favorite is the Cyclops skull from the back of Terrapin Station. That one's awesome. And then we have here, this is the one that you printed at the Bindweed, right?
Right, this is the one I played music to while it was being printed.
Yeah, it's on the street. And I put this
one. And that's the original one, right?
That is the Mooka.
The Mooka, yeah.
And you went and looked at a lot of Art Nouveau books at the San Francisco Public Library, right?
Yeah, I was really taken by Alphonse Mucha.
Yeah, and Art Nouveau, and you could see it in your line, or even when you were doing your monster art, that line was there.
When I was doing my Hot Rod Monster stuff, I went to art school, and my favorite class was life drawing. And in life drawing, it's all Art Nouveau lines, because it's the human body. So I noticed, after learning about Mucha and stuff, that I actually used a lot of Art Nouveau in my Hot Rod Monsters.
Yeah, it's true that you see it in that line.
And when I found out about Alphonse Mucha, that I went, I just felt a closeness from.
Yeah, and there were a lot of parallels between making the posters at the time you were and at the time of La Belle Epoque.
We did this poster at the Italian Street Painting Fair this summer at San Rafael. They built the whole fair around this poster.
Yeah.
It was kind of cool.
It was very cool. The reason I put this here, though, is actually to show this image. And this is an oil painting that you did recently. And I just wanted to show just how the human figure has always been important and just the diversity of your media. And just you're an unstoppable artist making art.
That's what I like doing now.
Yeah, it's a beautiful painting.
Thanks for putting that in.
Yeah, I love that painting. Yeah.
Thank you for your firehouse work.
So
when you see a fire company in a firehouse or a fire department with his work on it, that's beautiful. How many places can you go in the world that you see that?
Yes. Thank you. So I have in this picture, I think it's like around 1966.
This is 67.
Okay, the Pacific Ocean Trading Co., or POTCO. And this was a store that you opened up on Haight Street.
Yeah, in 67, with the Summer of Love and the influx of runaways and druggies and drug dealers from all over the country. There was like this giant population of people on the street.
Yeah.
And
it was really the golden time was 66.
And I rented this store on a storefront on Haight Street. We called it Pacific Ocean Trading Company, which abbreviated as POTCO.
What was the address? 1711.
All right, thank you. What's there now?
Close store. So all we had was a button machine, and so we went in there and started making buttons and selling buttons, and I had these proof sheets of photos of Janis Joplin. You know, the proof sheet is a lot of little pictures on one sheet, but they're perfect for a button, so I still have them. They're proof sheets with Janis Joplin's face cut out. There's a hole where her face is. And so we started making buttons, and we made enough to go down the street and buy a few loaves of bread and some bologna and cheese. And we all ate, which was kind of cool at the time. And then we started taking in people's handiworks, you know, beaded necklaces and things. And posters that we would make and silk screen things.
You silk screen the pig pen t-shirt, right? From the Grateful Dead?
Yeah, we silk screen a bunch of t-shirts.
$2 in the zigzag t-shirt. And the pig pen I found out was like $2.50, which is a steal, right? And I think that's the first time Grateful Dead went into merchandising as well.
Yeah. Probably, yeah.
Yeah.
They have a life-size photo of the Pacific Ocean Trading Company in the exhibition.
They do, on one of those leaning walls.
I was surprised to see that.
It's cool. It's in the Haight Street Gallery. So what was it like hanging out, you know, 1967 on Haight Street? You know, the kind of the golden time was over and there was a big change happening.
Well, it was like a a constant parade going on up and down the street with big bongs and fires and just up and down the street in costumes. And sometimes we'd lock the doors and put a bunch of seats out and just watch. It was amazing. And then the human being came up.
I've got the human being right here. Yeah. January 14th, 1967, the gathering of the tribes, right? The activists of Berkeley and the Bohemians of San Francisco come together. And just a year before, the first Family Dollar concert was about 1,000 people, and the human being in Golden Gate Park was estimated 40,000 to 100,000 people. Such a huge difference in such a short amount of time. And there were posters done for it. You did one of the posters for it. And you also did the cover of the Oracle. I know that Michael Bowen commissioned you for that. But I was wondering, what was your experience of the human being? I happen to have this picture here. I can work this clicker thing. There we go.
We silkscreened these flags. They had pot leaf on it. And put them on big bamboo poles. And we were also had it all ready, and we set off to take the flags to the human being in the morning, and we made a mistake of dropping some acid.
Nobody else did for the human being.
And so we carried these flags, and it was January, it was muddy, and walking through mud, and the flags turned into my cross. And I arrived there in total pain and in mud, and I've got my cross, and I say, here, take a flag, and nobody would want that. And I started kind of freaking out, and I usually never freaked out on acid. I always had great trips. And a friend of mine, Bob Seidman, saw that I was freaking out, and so he grabbed me and took me
Bob
back.
Bob Seidman, a photographer, right?
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
He took me back to my shop on Hay Street, and we had a great trip in my shop, and I missed the summer of love, and we just sat there laughing all day on how we missed the summer of love. Oh, not the summer of love, the human being.
Yeah. That's a trippy photograph, by the way, too, pink trees. Okay. March 1967, the first Grateful Dead cover.
Yeah, the Dead like Kelly some nice posters that we did for them. So
right. And that's like Herb Green photographs too, right?
Yeah, Kelly collaged Herb Green's photographs and then I did the lettering.
But what is that cryptic lettering at the top?
Oh, that said, it's the Egyptian Book of the Dead saying, I don't even know what it is.
I have it.
Something about drawn by the Grateful Dead.
It says, in the land of the dark, the ship of the sun is driven by the Grateful Dead. That's what it originally said.
And for some reason, they didn't want that to say be on there, so I made gibberish on it.
So that's why it looks that way now. And I know that's a later picture of you and Jerry Garcia, but it's a picture of you and Jerry Garcia, so I had to put it in. Yeah. Now this is a great photograph. You mentioned Bob Seidman, the person who helped you with your flag.
Yeah, and Bob Seidman took this photo.
And this is the Big Five. There are many important rockbuster artists, but this was the Big Five. And we have on the left, Alton Kelly, then Victor Moscoso, Rick Griffin, Wes Wilson, and you. And I have a question for you about the artists. I was just wondering what the dynamic was like. What was the working relationship? Was it competitive? Was it supportive? Did it reflect the scene at the time?
No, actually, each of us would do a poster and try to one-up the other guy. and it usually worked, and then the other guy would try to one-up the other guy. And it was a really healthy, wonderful. And then we started working together on posters. And then when I moved to England in 69 to London, they were always wondering how we could do that, you know, to work with each other and not be horribly competitive. They were so competitive, they wouldn't even talk to each other then.
I know you mentioned mentioned different cities you've been to, like LA, London, that just wasn't this kind of
vibe. I think what was happening in San Francisco, there was that, you know, peace bro, you know, and everybody got along.
And
it was not cool to not get along.
Yeah, so you
the funny thing about this photo is this is just before the joint show. It was a fancy show on Sutter Street at this fancy gallery by these wealthy gallery owners, older guys. And they came to see this picture or to talk to us, and they were going to give us 40% and they were going to take 60%.
The owners?
The owner. And we got them stoned for the first time ever.
Where was this taken?
That was in my studio. It was the other dead house. That the dead had two houses, and I had a studio on the upper floor in the other dead house.
So you got the gallery owners really stoned.
So they were stoned, and at this moment, Victor Moscoso, who was the lawyer of the bachelor, lawyer type, he said, "We're taking 60% and giving you 40. And then Bob clicked the shutter. Click.
That's why you guys look that way. That's a great story.
And what we had the joint show, and it was really, really amazing for me.
I have a picture of the joint show here. And for those who don't know, it was the first serious exhibition of rock posters and the featured works of the Big Five. And you had works in it, and you each made a poster for it. Sam Lee's at the top. And I love this photograph. What is going
that's
on in
me
this
carrying my artwork in there.
Oh, what was that? Like a textile piece.
It's a banner of some sort.
Yeah.
My poster, I did the lettering with roaches, like, you know. And it was hanging in there, and some guy said to the owner, he said, "I'm going to call the police. There's marijuana in this artwork." And the owner said, "Well, the chief of police is standing next to me. You can talk to him directly." Shut him up.
I have here Life Magazine, September 1967, the big poster hang-up. And this, you know, was the time of San Francisco scene, the poster scene was being propelled into mass media and mass consumption. And it was an interesting time because, you know, while the posters and the rock music were being propelled into popular culture, the scene in San Francisco was definitely, the social scene was going downhill, and I was just wondering your thoughts on this kind of change.
Yeah, everybody at first, the secondhand stores in San Francisco when we first got there were just full of Edwardian clothes, just tons of it. So everybody at the Avalon, in lace and stuff, you know, all this stuff is great. And we'd all dress in all these Edwardian clothes. And by the time 67 came around, the stores were picked over, and all the runaways that were there, the people who came in 67, they just went to the army surplus. So the styles went from Edwardian clothes to army surplus. And by the way, about the clothes, I don't know if I should say this, but the stuff in the exhibit, nobody ever dressed like that. Yeah. Maybe in Carnaby Street.
Well, a lot of the musicians did, though. So what did you? I remember you told me that when you first came to San Francisco, you were wearing Bermuda shorts and socks.
Tennis shoes and white socks and Bermuda shorts. I changed drastically.
Did you meet Keezy? What was he all about?
Actually, I missed that. I said hi to him and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, you came after the acid test had already begun, I believe. But
I always remember the further bus parked at the dead house and all those people in there, but I don't know, somehow I missed it.
Yeah.
There's so much going on.
Yeah. Well, I have, we're nearing the hour mark, and an hour with you is obviously not enough, but we have a picture of you now, and there's so much that we didn't get to cover. You've had a prolific career, as you mentioned, album covers and so many amazing things, but I, as long as I've known you, you have been an unstoppable artist. You always have a sketchbook on you. I know you have one in your bag right now. You probably have one in the trunk of your car. And I want to know, what kind of projects are you working on now?
The fun one, I think, was some guy, it was a bunch of guys with Ferraris, rich guys with Ferraris. They race their cars around. They have a whole race circuit, and he wanted me to design a Grateful Dead like wrap for it, and I did it.
Wrap for the Ferrari?
Yeah, they wrapped it in a big decal, and it was pretty cool, actually. I wish I had a slide of it. I can't wait to see it finished. Basically.
Wow. Well, Stanley, I just want to say thank you.
I got a good digger story.
A digger? Oh, yeah, let's have a digger story. We can just take questions.
I had this beautiful firehouse, and a digger came in 67 and said, can I fix a car here? And I said, sure, bro, you know. And then there were two cars, three cars, four cars. And I wake up in the morning, and I come downstairs, and they say, who the fuck are you? So I thought, it looks like this is the time to move. And so I left.
That's how you left the firehouse.
He pushed me out. I was lucky to get the studio at the Grateful Dead house after that.
Are there other questions out there?
You mean the perforations? I went to my printer and said, do this, and he did it.
What printer was that?
Actually, I went to see if he can do it no more, and he said he doesn't work for them anymore. It's very cool, and hopefully hi, Linda. Hopefully I'm going to be doing a painting group there in the future, maybe once a month.
Oh, that's cool.
It'll be fun. It'll be called a Secret Society of Figurative Artists.
Awesome. Are there any other questions after? There's one up there. Did you get pictures of that?
I've never heard that.
I think Herb Green has a picture with the parachute. Anyone else? I see a hand back there.
We weren't friends.
No.
Yeah, Ed Roth took my catalog, my monster character in my mouse character and took it to another artist and had this other artist do the Rat Fink from my catalog and then made the guy sign away his copyrights and Ed Roth signed his name to it.
Yeah.
Today?
Yeah.
Who? Myself? I'm starting a rock band. It's going to be called the Turds.
You said I could be the lead singer, right?
Yeah.
That's right. You look out for our single.
Keyboards and guitar.
Yeah, you played piano since you were a kid. You're good.
Yeah.
I told him he should have brought his guitar tonight.
I've been listening to this Chicken Shack, British blues band from 1969. Lately. Oh, no girl.
Is there a female singer?
No female singer.
That was actually the last thing they were very...
You know Chicken Shack?
Yes, wow. I saw them in Bath.
Robert Crump played some rockabilly blues band in the South of France somewhere?
Yeah, he plays, I don't know if it's rockabilly, he plays kind of... What? I don't know what kind of music
is.
Old-fashioned music. They were amazing in the 60s. So.
When did Stanley Miller become Stanley Mouse officially?
I was in the 7th grade, and I had a friend who called me Mouse Hole Miller. And I called him Bust Nuts Bugsy. And I said, well, drop the hole on the Miller, and I'll take it. And so, as soon as I started signing all my artwork in the 7th grade, I was instantly famous in the 7th grade.
Oh, we got one up here.
Was the Miracles, Mickey, Miracles album, was that your first album cover that you did?
Yeah, it was.
How did you get that gig?
I knew the art director, Bernie Yasin, and he gave me a job. He made $75. I made $35, and I did it on the back of a pizza pie lid.
But it's one of your monster art on the cover, right?
Kind of monster.
Yeah, it's cool.
Yeah, Smokey Robinson is trying. We're trying to hook up together in the last few years, but because of that, but we haven't been able to do that.
We got one on the side, and we got one in the center. We'll get you next.
Did you ever get together with the cartoonists like S. Clay Wilson?
Can you repeat the questions for us?
I will, yeah.
I came out of a really intense cartoon thing with my Hot Rod Monsters, and I was saying how Chet Helms said, we don't want no cartoons.
Yeah,
that stuck with me. And when everybody went into cartoons, I didn't. I quite don't understand it, but maybe it's a good thing.
There's a person here with a question, and I'll repeat it so you can hear it.
So, Mouse, you have an amazing repertoire of expression, which I happen to love the full breadth of it. But do you personally have a favorite? I mean, I've seen your life drawings, I've seen your landscapes, your monsters, your obvious rock and roll, but personally, deep down in who you are, does anything really, like, just resonate? Personally, whether it's a financial success or not.
I kind of like, in my painting groups, like, a model will sit there for 3 hours, and you have to sit there and paint a painting in 3 hours,
mm-hmm.
And just the it's such a charge. It's like as soon as my paint there's I have all this pain of life. I think everybody does, and as soon as my paintbrush hits the canvas, it's gone, mm-hmm. And then I just lose myself for 3 hours, mm-hmm. in this painting, and then at the end, sometimes it comes out really nice.
Thank you. You painted regularly for years, right?
What's that?
Your figure painting for years.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's someone back there, and then I'll get you.
Stanley, you have a typographic style that's very recognizable. How did it evolve?
So question is about his typographic style.
I think it's the basic handwriting. Or everybody's got their, you know, like musicians have their own song. They all have a song. I think artists all have a scrawl. And somehow it's just developed over the years, I guess, with a lot of influences.
Wants to know what draws him to do great redheads.
I never thought about that. You're a redhead. Only you would know.
it looks like we're
running
out of time. Any more questions?
It's
your last chance. Oh, one more.
I could tell a story about also the acid king running into my house.
I would love to hear that.
So there's two houses of Grateful Dead had on Ashbury Street, and I was in the other one, and it was on a big hill, a steep hill, and Kelly and I was in there drawing something or working on a poster, and we hear a clicky clicky clack, and it gets louder and louder and louder and louder, and we go, what's going on? And a big explosion, and we look out the window, and it's Oakley, the acid king, had run into our porch. His brakes gave out, and he could either go into the dead house or the dead annex house, or else go straight to his death on Ashbury Street, or on Hay Street. So he chose the house I was in, the annex house. He was okay, but destroyed the Volkswagen. And the porch.
Just because I love hearing Stanley talk, let's take another one back there.
Your dad worked for Disney, right?
Oh, yeah. Your dad, yes, if your dad drew for Disney.
How did he influence me?
He influenced you in what kind of characters did he draw for Disney?
Well, he did animation on Snow White in 1939. And, he didn't last long at it. It was pretty much slave labor. And so he went on. I was born in Fresno, and I've got Technicolor movies of my mom walking at Treasure Island with me in the oven. So cool.
So the California vibes got to you early on.
In 65, I came back like a salmon. She was amazing.